2 weeks ago, if you remember, I presented this idea that I wanted to take 2 weeks on called the opportunity of exile. And what we looked at is this idea that there is a new cultural moment that we are experiencing. That really for the first time in Western history, the church is in a different position than it's been. I threw out a few stats talking about how for the first time we are Americans that identify as Protestants is less than 50% for maybe the first time in our history. America was, some of us like to throw around that phrase, a Christian nation. I don't necessarily buy that. I think Christian's an adjective that describes people. It can't necessarily be itself, but we were certainly founded on Christian principles, and a Christian worldview was the dominant worldview in our history. And we are at a space now where the culture is shifting. That beneath our feet, we have experienced somewhat of a seismic shift in the way our world thinks, in the way our culture thinks and operates. I would say that it's really been the past probably 20 years coming, but even more so, like the last 10, 5, really the last 3 to 5 years, it has been heightened even more. We're seeing that certainly in an election year, which happy election week. We made it to the end. We survived. But I wasn't sure we were going to, but we did. But we've seen the culture shake beneath our feet in a new way. And 2 weeks ago when I presented some of this, I gave a few disclaimers and I said, let's not play the victim card. Our tendency For Christians, for the church, who have held a sort of cultural power, for better or worse, I think oftentimes maybe for worse more than good, and we explained a bit of that. But we often, because we've lost some sort of position or status, we love to play the victim card, and I just warned us. I said, let's not do that, because I don't think that's the posture the church should take. We don't blame, we don't point fingers at that, but rather we recognize that we are in a new cultural time, and we begin to kind of ask the question, what do we do in this space? How do we exist in a new time? Certainly there can be a time for lament and grief of maybe what was, but at some point the church has to begin to say, this is where we are. How do we exist in a new space, a new time? And it's disorienting. Right? I mean, and what I've called is that we're in some sort of exile. Exile is disorienting. We're pulled from the norms that we knew. For many of us, the world has changed so quickly, it's hard to keep up. By the time we keep up, it's already shifted again. And so we have to wrestle with how do we do church in kind of this new space in this new time. And so I talked about really last, or 2 weeks ago, how the main task we have to do is recover the narrative. That we have to remember who we are. And so we looked at the story of the people of God from Exodus to Mount Sinai. How the founding of the people of Israel, of God's people, was they were enslaved to Pharaoh for 400 years. In slavery, oppressed, no identity, stripped of any personal identity they had. It's taken from them, and they're working as slaves, empowering this world power, this oppressive world power in Egypt and in Pharaoh. And so they cry out to God, and for the first time in really religious thought, the divine God hears the cry, and he goes and saves the people of Israel solely because of what they, or nothing they had done, but solely because of God's movement. They go and he saves them, he pulls them from that slavery, draws them out into the wilderness, which was an important space, because no one could take claim over the wilderness. And God then declares, you will be my people. Right, this people without a land, without an identity, out just fresh out of slavery. And at Mount Sinai, when we receive the commandments and the law, we see Jesus or God saying, this is how you are human. This is what it means to be the people of God in a different alternative kind of space. And he gave them two specific roles. He said, you'll be a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. And we said that when we recover the narrative, that the way we exist in exile, the way we exist in this new cultural time, is to take up those tasks again to say, we are a kingdom of priests. We work in a way that is interactive in that personal sin, right? We talked about the dimensions of sin, that sin is both personal and systemic, and that sin is always pulling from the personal towards the systemic. And so we talked about how the kingdom of priests, that role is we give hope and life and resurrection to that personal sin. But we're also called to be a holy nation, which means that we operate in a different sort of system, a different means. And we talked about power and how the kingdom of the worlds, they use a power over posture, which is kind of coercive at its core. It's if you speed, you get a ticket, and that's supposed to enforce my behavior, right? That's kind of the kingdom of the power of the world. But that God works with a kingdom under, a power under, right? Where it's Jesus who got on his knees, washed his disciples' feet, and those sorts of acts began to transform the world. It's Jesus saying, I'm going to lay myself on the cross, say, Father, forgive them. And it's that sort of power that transforms the world, that defines us as a holy nation. And so for us, again, we're recovering this narrative. This is how we exist. So I want to give you a little bit of an idea of where we're going today. I want to hopefully put maybe a bit more kind of flesh on it, something to grab on that makes a bit more sense. Last or 2 weeks ago, was much more kind of ethereal and kind of big picture. I want to kind of hone in maybe on what is it that, how does this impact tomorrow? What do we do on Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday? And so I wanted to put a little more of that on it. And so we're going to talk about a foreign queen, okay, in a little bit. We're going to talk about a foreign queen. We're going to talk a bit about my outfit, which I know. I'm looking good. You guys all just looked. I know. We're gonna talk a bit about my outfit. We're going to talk about justice and righteousness. And then we're going to close talking about shalom and seeking the shalom of the city, which we talked about a bit last week as well. So before we do all of that, let's why don't we pray before we open the scriptures. Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to you and we bring so much with us from this week. And Lord, I pray that we bring that with us into this room and that we begin to work with that stuff, the good, the bad, Lord, because that is a part of us. So Lord, you have been here, you have been in this room already, you are here present now. And so Lord, we pray that as we bring that stuff, you help us to mesh. What does our life mean in light of what we do and learn and sing today? So God, speak to us. Open our minds, open our hearts, so that we may be more and more shaped into your people. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, if you have your Bibles, flip to Psalm 137. And in Psalm 137, we are looking at, again, this idea of exile, which is a theme that is laced throughout the scriptures. Okay, this idea of exile starts really in Genesis when Adam and Eve are cast out of the garden. That is a sort of exile. We talked about it last week in Exodus. When they're drawn out, they're in a sort of exile. And one of the things we have to understand about exile is that exile, almost exclusively, I can't think of a time where it isn't, but it is God sending the church into exile. It is not the fault of the big, bad, scary world or whatever you want to say, but rather it is God saying, something is awry, you need a time out, would be a good way to say it. Let's send you into exile, where then you recover kind of what our identity and our core is. And again, this happens all throughout Daniel. The book of Daniel is about Daniel in exile in Babylon. That's what we're kind of looking at primarily. You see it in Acts. You see it in 1 Peter. I think we talked about that verse. He addresses his letter to the exiles. All through scripture, this theme, this metaphor of the church in exile is there. And so what we see in Psalm 137 is a lament or a psalm that is sung by exiles. They are in Babylon, right, at this moment, and they write this song both lamenting but also asking, I think, a very important question that we'll be asking this morning. So if you're there, go ahead and listen along as I read verses 1 through 4. It says, by the waters of Babylon, there we sat and wept when we remembered Zion. On the willows there we hung up our lyres, for there our captors required of us songs. And our tormentors mirth, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion. And how shall we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? Right, so it begins with this kind of lament. They're looking and they're saying, we sat by the rivers in Babylon. We remembered Zion. We remember what we once had, this cultural power and influence in Jerusalem. Right, they said, we remember all of that. It says, there we sat and we began to weep. We began to sing these songs. Our captors, the Babylonians, they said, sing us a song of Zion, almost mocking them. And so they ask this question at the end, and they say, how shall we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? You see, I think this is the question that the church asks in exile. In our new cultural moment, we begin to say, how do we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? Because the world around us is different. And to sing the Lord's song in a different and foreign space is to begin to ask questions, say, how do we maintain our identity and yet live out the mission and the call of God in this space? How do we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? How do we do this? Because that's, again, the question the exiles are asking. It's the question that I think we have to ask. And it's the question, again, that we'll look at a bit more in depth today. And so we recover. We look at, okay, if they're in exile here, what got them there? Right? That should be a question we ask. Because Jerusalem, the people of Israel, were a people of dominance at one point. Right? They were in a world power position. And we're going to look at that. And so we have to ask the question, though, is how do they get to exile? Because history is cyclical, right? We all know that. It tends to repeat itself. And so asking those sorts of questions are important for us to look at. So in your Bibles, flip to 1 Kings chapter 10. We're going to talk about a foreign queen for a bit. And in 1 Kings chapter 10, this is now before the exile. Okay, so last or 2 weeks ago, we went from Egypt to the wilderness. Today, we're going to go essentially from Jerusalem, so after the wilderness, to exile, to Babylon. It's kind of what we're looking at, tracing that story. And so 1 Kings chapter 10, we see Solomon is in power. They're at the height of the empire. And we're going to read this exchange between Solomon and the queen of Sheba. And Sheba, they believe, is modern-day Yemen or Ethiopia. So just to give you kind of geography nerds a bit of maybe where we're at on that. But let's read verses 1 in chapter 10 through verse 6. Now when the queen of Sheba heard of the fame of Solomon concerning the name of the Lord, she came to test him with hard questions. She came to Jerusalem with a very great retinue. That's an advisory board is the best way to understand that. She came to Jerusalem with a very great retinue, with camels bearing spices and very much gold and precious stones. And when she came to Solomon, she told him all that was on her mind. And Solomon answered all her questions, and there was nothing hidden from the king that he could not explain to her. And when the queen of Sheba had seen all the wisdom of Solomon, the house that he had built, the food of his temple, the seating of his officials, the attendance of his servants, their clothing, his cupbearers, and his burnt offerings that he offered at the house of the Lord, there was no more breath in her. Verse 6. And she said to the king, "The report was true that I had heard in my own land of your words and of your wisdom. But I did not believe the reports until I came and my own eyes had seen it. And behold, the half of it was not told to me. Your wisdom and prosperity surpassed the report that I heard. Happy are your men, happy are your servants who continually stand before you and hear your wisdom. Blessed be the Lord your God who has delighted in you and set you on the throne of Israel. Because the Lord loved Israel forever, he has made you king that you may execute justice and righteousness." Okay, so Solomon has now grown in stature, grown in fame, that the wealth and the position and the power of Israel has begun to spread, so much so that foreign royalty are coming to see if what they hear is true. And so Sheba shows up, and what she sees, literally it says, takes her breath away. It says right there in verses kind of 3 through 5, right? She sees all of these things, the house he built, the food on his table, his officials, his servants, their clothing, the cupbearers, the burnt offerings, all of this, and it literally takes her breath away. Like, she is floored by this. Later on, right, she says that I had heard of it, but I had to see it for myself, and when I saw it, they didn't even cover half of it. I mean, Israel is at its dominance. It is a picture of opulence. It is a picture of wealth that the world really has never seen. It's believed that Solomon is still the richest man to have ever lived. I mean, it is Israel at its height. The promises of Sinai have come true here. Because remember, at Sinai, God says, "You will be my people, and you will have that success, you will have that position, that influence, all that." He says, "You will be my people." But remember, the promise was always that the people of God will be a blessing to all the people. Right? That it was, "I will empower you so that you may be a blessing to all the world." right? This is the kind of position it's in. And so we see Sheba, she's blown away by all of this. And one of the things that stands out to her in verse 9, right, is that God has made you king. I've heard about the God of Israel, and he has placed you, Solomon, in power so that you may execute justice and righteousness. That is that reminder of their role. This foreign queen is saying, I've heard of your God. Your God works different than the rest of the kings of the world. Your power is for justice and righteousness. See, for Pharaoh, his power was so that he could crush others for his benefit, to fuel his kingdom, to fuel his luxury, to fuel his all like his desires, everything he wanted. That's why he was oppressing the Israelites. That's why every empire we've seen in the world has really at some point defaulted to that, where they begin, like power corrupts, right? It wants to consume for its own sake. And so the Queen of Sheba comes and she says, listen, your God is different. You're here for justice and righteousness. Now, if we were to stop there, that would be a great story. Rags to riches, right? It was this oppressed, enslaved people have now dug themselves out. God has brought them to this position of dominance. But the problem with 1 Kings 10 is it comes after 1 Kings 9 and before 1 Kings 11. So let's look at that a bit, all right? So go to 1 Kings chapter 9, and we'll just be in verse 15. Because again, the question we should be asking as we see Israel in this position of dominance is how do they get in 2 Kings, a little further, they find themselves in exile. So how in just a short time do they go from this position of power and dominance and opulence and everything that, the world has to offer to exile? Right, well, let's look at verse 15 in chapter 9. And this is the account of the forced labor that King Solomon drafted to build the house of the Lord and his own house, and the Millo, and the wall of Jerusalem, and Hazar, and Megiddo, and Gezer. Did you catch it right at the beginning? This is the account of the forced labor. What's another way to say forced labor? Slavery. The oppressed have become the oppressors. Solomon, in all of his glory and grandeur and power, had built the house of the Lord, the very temple of God, his own house, the Millo, which was an outer fortifying of the walls. It was kind of a secondary wall. And then it says that he had built the wall of Jerusalem. Hazar, Megiddo, and Gezer were gates into the city that represented significant trade routes. So the picture here is that this is the account of how Solomon built this incredible empire that we would, or that the world would consider an incredible empire, but he did it all on the backs of slaves. You see, Solomon had lost the story. He had somewhere along the way, because of wealth, because of power, it had corrupted his thinking and made him blind to the cry of the oppressed, which is where they were founded. Right, the beginning of our story, the beginning of Solomon's story is a people oppressed in Egypt, and that because they have come from this, they are no longer a blessing to all the nations, but instead they have become the very thing that God saved them from. That he is now enforcing slavery. He is very much utilizing a systemic sin, a systemic issue to enslave a people to build a kingdom for him. Think about what stood out to the Queen of Sheba in chapter 10. He goes in and everything she notes is specifically connected to Solomon. I've seen your officials, your servants, your tables. I've seen your house. Everything she's impressed with is about this opulence that Solomon is experiencing. That he has got to this place, he's built this, what I would call a kingdom of apathy and indifference. He has, or really maybe a better phrase would be the kingdom of comfort. He has used his power to let him collect whatever he wants for his sake, for his comfort. And they have become the very thing that God saved them from at the beginning of the story. He has built a kingdom on the backs of slaves. He has lost the narrative. No longer is he executing justice and righteousness, which is what the Queen of Sheba thought she would find, but instead is employing this forced labor. Well, let's look at 1 Kings 11. Let's jump to the other side of chapter 10. Because again, there's this issue that they are to be a kingdom of priests and a holy nation, a blessing to all the nations. They've missed the mark in this systemic way. But what we see in chapter 11 is Solomon has also gone off the wire in a personal way as well. And so we're going to see the way that power and that position has corrupted a bit. And so let's look at 1 Kings chapter 11, verses 1 through 8. It says, "Now King Solomon loved many foreign women, along with the daughter of Pharaoh, Moabite, Ammonite, Edomite, Sidon, and Hittite women. From the nations concerning which the Lord had said to the people of Israel, 'You shall not enter into marriage with them, and neither shall they with you. For surely they will turn away your hearts after their gods.' Solomon clung to these in love. He had 700 wives, 700 wives who were princesses, and 300 concubines. And his wives turned away his heart. For when Solomon was old, his wives turned away his heart after other gods, and his heart was not wholly true to the Lord, his God, as was the heart of David, his father. For Solomon went after Ashtoreth, the goddess of the Sidonians, and Milcom, the abomination of the Ammonites. And so Solomon did what was evil in the sight of the Lord and did not wholly follow the Lord as David, his father, had done." Verse 7. "Then Solomon built a high place for Chemosh, the abomination of Moab, and for Molech, the abomination of the Ammonites, and on the mountain east of Jerusalem. And so he did for all his foreign wives who made offerings and sacrificed to their gods." Solomon's heart had been turned away from God. Now, we read this, and we read it rather quick, and the first thing, and probably the only thing we tend to pick up on, is that he had a very busy Valentine's Day, right? A thousand women in his life, right? That's a busy day. Okay, but what we miss in that is that as we read, the way that his heart had turned away from God towards these other gods is this very dark, dark stuff. We don't see it initially, but the God in verse 7, where it says that he built a high place for Molech, the abomination of the Ammonites. Molech is the god most associated with child sacrifice. I mean, this is dark, dark stuff. The power, the position, the everything that came with Solomon's grandeur blinds him to the cry of the oppressed, turns his heart towards dark, dark stuff. Dark stuff. Because he'd lost the narrative. He'd lost the story. So, a bit about my outfit. How's that for a hard shift? If you were to investigate this shirt that I'm wearing today, which my wife hates this shirt, I think it's lovely. She'll hate me for saying that, actually. But if you were to investigate this shirt, you would look on the tag and you would find that this shirt is made in Bangladesh. Okay, and I would make a pretty good argument that the majority of our clothes in here is made in Bangladesh. Bangladesh is home to 5,000 garment factories. Okay, it is the number 2 exporter of clothing in the world behind China. Right, it is. They take orders and they produce garments for nearly all of the world's top brands of clothing. So the majority of places you shop, they're probably sourcing at some level their clothing from Bangladesh. Well, some of you, if you remember back in 2013, there was a story that came out of Bangladesh, specifically out of Rana Plaza, and if you were to search that, this is the picture you would find. In April 23rd, 2013, this factory, named Rana Plaza in Dhaka, Bangladesh, collapsed. And the reports were that the day before, they had found cracks in the building. What was happening was the owner or the manager of this factory, right, was in a position where he is taking these orders from the world's largest companies, and the increasing demand of what the fashion industry calls fast fashion. Right, and some of you, I don't know if you're familiar with this, there's a great documentary called The True Cost that's on Netflix, it's worth a watch. But they cover this idea of fast fashion. It's the idea that, you've noticed this, right? Like clothes have overall been dropping in price, which is interesting as everything else has kind of tend to be on the rise a bit. The clothing industry has begun to kind of drop their prices, and this phrasing fast fashion comes from the idea that rather than buying clothes and keeping them for their lifetime, they're making them cheaper, turning it around quicker, and doing it all at the expense of really what we see here. And so the owner of this factory on April 23rd, 2013, he found cracks in his building. He had been building levels on top of itself without proper certification or any of that. And what the problem became was they couldn't produce enough power in these buildings to keep up with the demand from these big companies. So he began to install these generators in each of these floors. And when the power goes out, these generators kick on. The reports were that the walls would shake. And eventually, it gave these cracks in the walls. Well, at the very bottom floor of this, on April 23rd, there was this bank, and the owner of the bank saw these cracks, and he demanded that his workers do not come back to work the next day until they figure out what was going on. Well, April 24th rolls around. No one's in the bottom floor, but the rest of the floors where the garment factories were, his employees, he forces back into the building because of this increasing demand or an account of the forced labor. And he gets his men back into the, or his workers back into this building. The generators kick on, the building collapses, and 1,130 workers die. 2,500 others injured because of this shirt in Bangladesh. There's an element where we have to begin to ask questions that I think Solomon forgot to ask. Where we say, are we a part of any sort of system that may be oppressing others? Or are we in any way a part of a system that is a forced labor? We have to ask these questions. This is how we exist in exile. In a way where we may not have the same cultural power and influence, we have a different lens, a kingdom perspective, where we say, what are we a part of in every way in a globalized world that's smaller than it's ever been? The very decisions we make here very much affect people around the world. And so we begin to ask those sorts of questions. Now, this isn't just to pour on all sorts of guilt. I wore this shirt, I picked this shirt out because I am wrestling with how we as the people of God do this. How do we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? We have a new vision, a new perspective. So let me tell you about my pants. If you were to investigate my pants, which again, take my word for it, you would come to the tag and you would find that my pants were made in Sri Lanka by a company named Patagonia. Well, a couple years ago, Patagonia, which again, I think most of us are familiar with, they made a change in the way they operate, and they saw stories like that and what the fashion industry was doing to people around the world and said, that's not acceptable to us. And so they began to make a change where they said, we want to now source ethical clothing. We want to source clothing that doesn't oppress others, that doesn't, you know, force people into working for lower wages, where and a lot of the reports, unfortunately, out of Bangladesh is that conditions haven't changed. That they're still forced to work for an unlivable wage, for hours beyond what they can bear. If they start to unionize, they're threatened with gang violence. But Patagonia says, no, we want to do things differently. And so they're writing a new story. They're ethically sourcing. They're working and giving workers a fair wage, a livable wage, conditions that are productive. They give them conditions that are safe and help them flourish in the communities they source their clothing from to flourish as well. They said, no longer is my bottom line just our income, but what is the impact that we're having on the world around us? They said, that's our bottom line. And I hear that and I think they are doing gospel work and they don't even know it. That they are doing exactly, they have the vision, they asked the questions that I believe the church needs to ask in exile and say, you know what, how do we rethink the way we do every bit of our life? How do we rethink and have this new perspective, what I would call the kingdom as a new organizing principle in our life, where everything in us is organized and shaped around the kingdom of God? I mean, this is what we talked about in the Sermon on the Mount. Over and over, as Jesus is saying, repent, for the kingdom of God is here. Remember, that word repent, at its core means think differently about the world. You could trace it back to almost, it's this picture, it has all sorts of meanings, but the main picture is think different. Jesus bursts onto the scene amongst a world power in Rome where they're oppressing his people. He comes on the scene and he says, think differently about the world. There's a new way to be human and I embody that. Come along with me. He says, let me bring the kingdom of God, a new vision, a new way that we organize every part of our lives. We organize the way we spend money, the way we eat. We recognize our relationships in work and in friendship and our neighborhood. Everything comes under and is reorganized by the kingdom of God. It deals with both the personal and the systemic. It offers hope and healing to people that are trapped in sin, but it also stands up for justice and righteousness like Solomon should have. It is this picture, this vision, this reorganizing of the way we view the world to bring hope and to bring healing. It is Jesus's prayer, your kingdom come, your will be done in Sebastopol as it is in heaven. That is the prayer of the disciples. That is the prayer that Jesus says, you are coming and you are quite literally bringing heaven to earth. That when we enter the kingdom of God, when we recognize Jesus, we call him Lord, we call him our teacher, our rabbi, our leader, whatever that is, we call him that because he is working to bring heaven to earth, or what Paul would say, the reconciliation of all things. And he invites us along the way and he says, come do the work of reconciliation with me. So we ask questions. We look at with fresh eyes on the world. We say, are there ways, are there any ways that we may be producing more death, more brokenness than we should? Well, I think historically the church responds in kind of two ways that are damaging, right? And one from the theologically conservative, okay, I'm not using political terms here, but theologically conservative, and the other would be from the theological liberal. Right, again, not political terms, but theological terms. And what happens is we tend to, if the theologically conservative, we want to separate. The posture is that of separatism. We want to, and this is, think of the Amish, right? Great followers of Jesus, but the problem with separating is to separate and hide away from culture, right? It means we cannot be a blessing to all the nations. If we are separate and we are hidden away, not interacting with the world, we can no longer fulfill that very calling to be a blessing to all the world. This is the turtle posture, would be a good way to put it. It's sticking your head out, seeing the world's big, bad, and scary, and then hiding back on church on Sundays. That's the posture, the turtle posture, right? We can't embody that because that will miss the mark of what our call is to be. Well, on the other side, again, the theological kind of liberal, the tendency there is that we want to syncretize. We want to blend in. This would be the chameleon posture. We want to just look like everything around us. And so we lose our distinction in the way of Jesus, that Jesus says there are certain things about the kingdom of God, the way you operate. And if we just syncretize with the world around us and blend in, we lose our distinct calling, right? If separatism is blind indifference to the kind of the world and injustice, syncretism would be kind of blind perpetuation of injustice. And so what I would say is we need not these, and I don't have a fancy S word to use here, but we would use, I would call integration. I think the vision for the church in exile is that we don't separate, we don't just blend in, but instead we own our identity. The way we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land is we own our identity, we own our way of living, and we live within the community. This is Jesus in Matthew 28, at the Great Commission, right? He says, go into all the nations, teaching them, or making them disciples and teaching them my ways, on and on and on. Well, we've talked about this. The phrasing isn't go into all the nations. It's better translated in your goings, in your Mondays and Tuesdays, in your work, wherever it is, you bring the kingdom of God. You ask the question, how do I bring better life, healing, and resurrection here? Where you find yourself on Tuesday at 10 a.m. How do you bring healing? Because what we need is not, I would argue, we don't need more pastors. We think being called to ministry means you do what I do, you go and be a pastor. I think we need people who are third grade teachers saying, I am here to bring the kingdom of God. I am here as a plumber, as a contractor to bring wholeness and life. I am here as a lawyer and a doctor to bring the kingdom of God where I find myself. The way of Jesus is not being confined in these walls, but rather in our goings, whatever your goings may be, you find yourself bringing healing and hope and more love and more goodness to this world around us, because that is how we become a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. Is to live out this calling in our everyday. Oh, church, if we grasped this, and we could, I mean, we would integrate in a way that bring, like the people would, it would transform their thinking of the church. We would be this small minority, but we would be this powerful force for good and for love. Because again, this is the vision that Jesus has for us. Flip back to Jeremiah 29, and we'll end on this text. But again, Jeremiah 29, I presented 2 weeks ago at the beginning of that. And in Jeremiah, again, we're familiar with verse 11, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Great verse. What we often forget as we're drinking our coffee with that labeled on the front of it is that that meant exile. That meant a lot of pain and difficulty. So painted on our walls, but recognize it's probably not as cute as we thought. And it really means that the church will be cast out into exile to remember who we are. Right, and so we come to the beginning before that, and again, this is Jeremiah writing to the exiles. He is literally writing a letter to Daniel saying, this is how you exist in exile. And I think this is the vision that we have, this integrated approach to the culture. Right, Jeremiah 29, verse 4 says, thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all the exiles, and note this, whom I have sent into exile. It was God's doing. God sends them into exile to remember, not someone else. Verse 5, build houses and live in them. Plant gardens and eat their produce. Take wives and have sons and daughters. Take wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage, that they may bear sons and daughters. Multiply there, do not decrease, but seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile. And pray to the Lord on its behalf, for in its welfare you will find your welfare. The vision Jeremiah has from God to the exiles is to root yourself in where you are. It's build houses, plant gardens, marry your kids, have grandkids. It's the idea he's saying is you're going to be there for a while. You will be in exile and that's okay. Be the people of God there. He says, do it, build houses, plant gardens, marry your children, all of that. And he says, in that, seek the welfare of the city. Because in its welfare, you will find your welfare. I think one of the fundamental roles of the church is to fight and seek the common good of our culture. It is we champion the things that are bringing life in our culture. We critique the things that perpetuate injustice and brokenness. That we stand as this people seeking the shalom of the city because we recognize in its prospering, we too prosper along with it. It is a vision to integrate deeper into the culture around us. Church, this is a mighty, mighty task. It's tough. But church, this is our call. This is our cultural time. And so may we stand in this space. That's disorienting and difficult and frustrating and hard at times, but may we stand for hope and for the resurrection here and now. May we stand for the kingdom of God in Sebastopol as it is in heaven. May we learn to have a new vision, a new organizing principle, to ask deep, penetrating questions about the way the world works and say, you know what? We can't stand for that. We have to think differently than that. And may we embrace this new picture, this new opportunity of exile to remember who we are as a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. And we say, God, may we be used by you in a new and a fresh way, because that's our task. So will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, Lord, God, as we think about our world, as we think about the way, God, things are changing, culture's changing, or my hope is that we don't fall back into seeking and pursuing methods of existing or reaching for power in the kingdom of the world sense. But may, Lord, may we embrace the narrative. May we come to a new realization of how we operate and work in the world. God, help us. Help us to see the ways that we are entrapped in power games that our culture plays. Lord, help us to renew that vision of the power under, Lord, of you sacrificing and loving, and in that way we influence the world. And so, Lord, may you give us that new vision. God, thank you for being patient and gracious with us, Lord, as we need that patience and that grace. And so, God, as we leave this place, may we recognize that our work doesn't end. We do not come here and then leave and live our lives, but rather this is a piece of who we are. And in our goings, may we bring the kingdom, bring heaven onto earth in Sebastopol. And so Lord, help us with that because we need help. But thank you for grace and for love and for forgiveness as we try to figure this thing out. So Lord, we love you and we try to mean that. In Jesus' name, amen.